strangely strange, but oddly normal.
Why am I sticking a needle into my thumb? Well, you may well ask. As regular CFZ watchers will know, I'm a diabetic. And for various reasons, recently my blood sugar levels have got out of control. So I have to regularly test my blood sugar. Which reminds me of an old poem. And furthermore, it's a poem with a slightly sinister set of connotations.
By the pricking of my thumb, something very sweet this way comes.
Well, I noticed you changed the word from wicked to very sweet. But to what very sweet might you be alluding? Is this some sort of veiled reference to my blood sugar? Or could it be? Goodness me, it's Matt Osborne.
So what do we have here, Matthew?
We have a 7-month-old ginger and white Tom being rehomed because the previous people couldn't keep him in the flat they've got to move to. And he's becoming the new orange cat to CFZHQ.
Well, you might ask what we're going to do now. What's going to happen about Spider up in Staffordshire? Well, we decided to take a leaf out of the Vatican's book. If it's okay for the Pope, it's okay for the orange cat. And now for something that I thought I wouldn't be saying for a long time. Hi, my name's John Downs, this is the Orange Cat, and welcome to a new episode of On The Track. Well, a few weeks ago, round about Valentine's Day, it stopped raining, the sun came out, and it felt like it was spring. Spring lasted for about 3 days before it got very, very cold. And now, at the beginning of March, we're right back in wintertime again. But it's still fairly dry, and so we're resuming our daily walks. This is good both from my health point of view and Prudence's health point of view. But it's also a chance to get out away from the office and into the countryside. This is a time of year that, especially since coming back to live in the country 8 years ago, I have become very, very fond of. It's very peaceful, quiet and still out here at Huddisford. We're the only people stupid enough to be out in this cold weather, and it seems like we have the whole world to ourselves. I hobble along with my stick, and I hope I don't sound like I'm belly aching too much, but every step is painful. But it's rewarding, not just because I know that I'm burning off some of my excess blood sugar, but because I manage to see the way that the world progresses on a micro level. Even if on some days, like today, Huddisford Plantation is horribly reminiscent of one of those famous photographs of the Russian forests after the Tunguska event of 1908, when a meteorite, or some people believe a UFO, crashed into the forest, causing enormous amounts of devastation. Only this wasn't caused by a meteorite or even a UFO. It was caused by the Forestry Commission last year harvesting a large proportion of the trees in this part of the forest. It's quite unnerving walking along here now. I've been visiting here since about 1972, and up until last year it was always thick, impenetrable forest. Now, it's a wasteland. And it's not the only one. Look at this. Once again, the unseasonably warm weather at the beginning of January caused the frogs to lay their eggs. Well, as anybody who watched last month's On The Track will remember, we went out and collected some samples of this frog spawn, fearing that what actually did happen would happen. That the unseasonably mild weather would be replaced by a cold snap, which would kill a whole generation of frog spawn. And this is exactly what's happened. Look at this, the frog spawn's badly damaged and it looks like it's rotting. And here you still can see ice on the surface of the ditch. The desolation of the scene is compounded by the fact that this is the time of year when the farmers and the highways authorities do what needs to be done in terms of cutting back hedgerows and clearing ditches, so the whole place looks violated. It's not, of course. I'm perfectly aware of the fact that we live in a completely artificial ecosystem these days in Britain, and that hedgerows need to be trimmed, ditches need to be dug in the same way as that lawns need to be mowed and fertiliser needs to be put on the garden. But it's still a shock to see it. And it's peculiar to see that despite the appalling levels of rain that we've had all winter, that the water table seems to be dropping, and the places which this time last year were ponds are now shallow grassy hollows. But enough of my slightly depressing look at the countryside this month. A couple of weeks ago we had a real celebration. The CFZ is a very real family, and about 3 weeks ago the newest member of the family, as far as I'm aware, made his first public appearance. Ladies and gentlemen, may I introduce to you Dougal Taylor Rose.
We just want to say thank you to everyone for coming far and wide to come along and spend this lovely day with us. It's meant the world to Brady and I, Dougal. I've got to keep this short because I don't know how much longer I'm going to be able to keep you calm. I need to get photos of him cutting the cake.
As regular CFZ watchers will know, Tim and Grady have been CFZ volunteers for a couple of years now, and we were very touched to be invited along to Dougal's christening. We enjoyed ourselves immensely, and we look forward to being more involved in his life as he grows up. And I can tell already he's going to become a famous cryptozoologist one day. We've been out and about quite a lot over the last few weeks, because at the end of January, after having been here for 3 months, Mother went home. We all miss her immensely and will be glad when she comes back to us sometime in April. But she lives in a flat in Oakham, the county town of Rutland, the smallest county in Britain. And so we took her back there at the end of January and took advantage of the chance to have a look around. We stopped off in Northamptonshire to visit a historical monument that Corinna in particular has always wanted to see.
Eleanor of Castile was the queen consort of Edward I. After 36 years of marriage and 16 pregnancies, in 1290 at the age of 49 she died at Harby in Nottinghamshire. Originally perhaps wooden, Edward had monuments erected between 1291 and 1294 to mark the places where the body of his beloved wife was rested nightly on the roads to Westminster Abbey. The journey took 12 days, and of the 12 monuments erected, only 3 survive. This one in Geddington in Northamptonshire is the best preserved, but there is also one still at Hardingstone in Northamptonshire and at Waltham Cross in London. Even then, these are not in their entirety. They have all lost the crosses that stood atop them. Nothing at all remains of some of the others, whilst remnants of some of those lost are to be found at other sites. Available evidence indicates that Eleanor and Edward were devoted to each other, and he is purported to have written of her, "whom living we dearly cherished, and whom dead we cannot cease to love." In the days of arranged royal marriages, which so often could hardly have been called happy, the erection of these monuments is a testament to one of the greatest love stories in history, and the fact that at least 3 still survive today, after all these centuries, is a pretty good testament to the craftsmanship of the day as well.
This isn't a sight that you expect to see in Warwickshire in February. My lovely wife Corinna, in conjunction with the pupating caterpillar of one of the silk moths. Can you guess where we are? Yes, we're at Stratford Butterfly Farm. And we're guests of your friend and mine, Carl Marshall. Carl has been a member of the CFZ for a couple of years now, and he's becoming increasingly important within the organisation. He has been working at the Stratford Butterfly Farm for some years, and has been inviting us to come up and see him for a long time. Finally, this February, after taking Mother home to Oakham, we managed to get to him. And what a treat it was. It was irresistibly reminiscent of the places where I used to play when I was a child in Hong Kong, and the places where I spent the happiest hours of my not very happy childhood. In fact, so emotive was it, that it was hard at times to behave in a civilised manner towards Corinna and Carl, when all I wanted to do was to go off into a corner and daydream. Although there were butterflies from all over the tropics flying together in the great tropical hall, some of them were old friends of mine, like this, Graphium Agamemnon, named after a mighty hero king of ancient Greece, and with the rather less emotive common name of the Lesser Green Triangle. Together with its cousin, Graphium Sarpedon, the Blue Triangle, it's one of my favourite butterflies of the Orient. Whereas I have been having a love affair with tropical butterflies, particularly the papilionids, since I was a little boy, there is no doubt that Corinna's favourite invertebrates are these, the leaf-cutting ants. And I, too, have always found their complex social structure fascinating. But I didn't realise quite how much work they were to maintain.
These ones that take up most of your life, are they?
Yeah, absolutely. Pretty much ongoing all the time.
Why do they take up so much effort?
As soon as they escape, and it does happen every now and again, it takes about 10 minutes to lose about 50,000. So that's what the problem is, and you have to sort of collect them all again then. So you have to have an empty hoover that's never been used to suck them back up, which has got no dust in it, so they don't die, basically, so then we can pour them back into the nest. And it usually takes about half a day.
And how many have you got in here, do you think?
How many ants?
How many of this particular species?
Oh, I wouldn't know, John. Probably 500,000, something like that, as a guess.
Jesus. I think your biggest problem would be thinking of names for all of them.
Yeah, that would be.
So what's this one?
This is a soldier ant of the leaf-cutting ants.
How many different castes are there of the leaf-cutting ants?
I don't know exactly, but I think there's about eight different castes. This being the largest.
And those are the only ones that, if they bite, they'll actually hurt.
Yes, and these are all females, every one of them. They're all sisters.
I've also always had a soft spot for phasmids.
So where are these from?
These are from Malaysia.
Aren't they gorgeous? How long do they live when they're that size?
About a year. Not long. And they spend about 3 years in an egg.
That is fantastic. Did you breed these ones here?
Yes. Really, really dimorphic, aren't they?
Very much so. In order to keep so many pristine insects on show, have you got a lot of stuff off show which you use to...
Yeah, we've got a variety of them out the back. In fact, I can show you some babies of these if you like.
Wow. And you've got my favourite here, the Peruvian blacks.
Yes. Yeah, they're fantastic.
This is a particularly interesting species. It comes from the cold rainforests of Peru, fairly high up in the Andes, and it has a very small natural range, but the Peruvian authorities harvested these and sold them at a high price to Western enthusiasts, and the money raised from selling the insects has ensured the survival both of the species and of the area in which they live. And he even had something of possible cryptozoological importance.
Jesus, he's an active little fellow, isn't he?
Yeah. That's 20 segments, so it's not a scolopendromorph. But I don't know what it is yet.
Okay, tell me the story. Where did he come from?
I just got given him out of the blue, basically, by one of my colleagues. We had a shipment of pupa come in from Africa, and he was in there, basically. Not a bit more to it than that, really.
And how long have you had him?
About a week. Just under a week.
Whereabouts in Africa?
That I don't know, actually. I'm going to find that out.
So that's the trouble. Africa is quite a large continent.
Yeah, we get a lot of pupae from Africa, from all over it as well.
Do you get a lot of odds and sods turning up like this?
Yeah, all the time. This is a little horned gecko. It's just up there. Which obviously had an injury at some point, but grew horn-like.
Can you bring him over a little?
It's flat-tailed, isn't it?
Yes.
I love geckos. And the little horn on his head is actually just a shell. A scale that's...
It's formed wrong.
Ah. Where did he come from?
I would actually have to double check because I've forgotten actually.
No, and how did you get him?
He was brought in to me from somebody that had been away on holiday. And he was, yes, that's right, he was in their luggage. I think it was Barbados.
That's fantastic. I've really, really enjoyed this, Carl.
It's my pleasure, please.
And if we may, we'll come back again soon.
Any time.
But all too soon, it was time to get back on the road and go home. I seem to have spent so much of my life travelling up and down the arterial roadways of England. But it's an experience that I wouldn't have missed for the world. We got home to some good news. Much to our great pleasure, our aequidens species Peru, the unidentified South American cichlid that we've been studying for some years, has bred for the second time. It bred for the first time in 2010, and for the last 2 years it hasn't bred. But this year, apparently, it has. Well done to Graham, who's been in charge of the fish tanks since Ol left. Also, while we were away, a titanic battle of wills took place. It took place between Graham and a robin, who insisted on invading the pheasant aviary each day in search of food and then getting stuck.
Well, just going into the hallway or airlock, or whatever one likes to call it. Now, the game plan is to shoo the robin into this hallway. But I've got to block the gap at the top of this door that's not in use. Where are we here? Oh yes, there we go. Right, I've blocked the gap at the top of this doorway that's not in use. Now to round up the robin. Oh! Damn it, he's gone in there, yes. Right, that's the first step. He's now confined in the airlock. And I'm going to join him there, which he's not going to like one little bit. Now I exit and leave the door open. Come on, don't just sit there. Yeah, he's getting there. He's hopping along the top of the door. And he's away.
And now back to a subject which is of perennial interest to us here at the CFZ, the tadpoles of Huddisford. As you will remember, last month Graham and I took samples from two locations here, on the left and the right-hand sides of this little track in Huddisford Plantation. The main difference between the two locations is that the water on the right-hand side is moving, so presumably it's more oxygenated than that on the left. Sadly, the frost, as we have already seen, has damaged the eggs that we left. However, whether they are damaged beyond repair has yet to be seen. The nuclei had begun to develop, but they seem to be in a state of arrested development since the frosts. Only time will tell whether any of the wild frogs born of this generation will hatch and live to maturity. Personally, I doubt it. But both sets of tadpoles in the bathroom were growing quite nicely. However, the developmental stages of them were completely different. The ones marked R, which were the ones taken from the right-hand side, where the running water was, developed much more fast than the ones on the left-hand side. and they hatched while the ones on the left-hand side were still only slightly developed embryos within the eggs. Then we went away to Wokeham and came back after 4 days to find something very peculiar had happened. Whereas the ones from the right-hand side were developing quite nicely, the ones on the left-hand side had all hatched almost overnight, and a large number of them were dead. They were much smaller and much weaker than the ones on the right-hand side. Corinna put them quickly into clean water and added some aerating weed and fed them, and for a while it looked as if they were going to survive. But no, after a few weeks the ones from the left-hand side of this track died. The ones from the right-hand side, the ones that were laid into running water, are not only still with us, but doing rather well. None of this is conclusive yet, but it is showing quite a few of the environmental factors that may well affect the development of the frogs in the area. While still on the subject of frogs and tadpoles, in the last month we also managed to add some data to an ongoing debate which has been happening since earlier in the year some mysterious slime was found at a nature reserve in Somerset. The story began when I received a press release from my friend Tony at the RSPB. The press release read, "In the shadow of Glastonbury Tor, the RSPB is investigating the appearance of a strange jelly-like substance on the popular Ham Wall Nature Reserve. As yet, the mystery slime is unidentified." Interesting. My first thought was that it was going to be a slime mould, like the ones that we found at Durden Farm outside Walsley a few years ago. But no, it appeared to be something slightly more macabre. A second press release was issued later on. In it, Tony Whitehead said, "We've been delighted by the number of people who have contacted us about the mystery slime," and continued, "The RSPB was contacted by Peter Green, a Devonshire vet who works with wildlife, who gave a particularly logical and simple explanation following his own researches. At this time of year, amphibians are spawning. The spawn is held in a subject known as glycoprotein, which is stored in the female's body. If the animal is attacked by a predator, herons, for example, are fond of the occasional frog, it will quite naturally drop its spawn and the associated glycoprotein. This is designed to swell on contact with water, which gives the gelatinous mass we're all familiar with in frog spawn. However, if it's unfertilized, it's just the empty glycoprotein that is dropped, which on contact with moist ground will swell and give a clear slime-like substance." Well, that's a very good description. It's a very good explanation. I just have to think it's not necessarily always the truth. Because that afternoon, Corinna and I and Prudence went out for our daily trot up to Huddisford to see about the developmental stages of the frog spawn that we'd been monitoring, and we found this. See, it's actually frog spawn that a predator has eaten. Or rather, it has eaten quite a lot of the nuclei from the frog spawn and left the jelly. In the same way as for some people who weren't brought up as strictly as I was, would pick and choose which parts of a meal they want to eat. Interesting, huh? Watch this space. I'm sure this story is going to develop more in the weeks and months ahead. Also, whilst we were out on our walks, we found some other things of interest, like this ant's nest. You really don't expect to see something as complex and as beautiful as this by the side of a road in rural Devon in February. And these paw prints. Cat? Dog? Or something else entirely? What do you think? And this wool is presumably from a sheep or lamb. But what's it doing here mixed up with some droppings miles from any farmer's fields? Who killed it? What's responsible for the droppings? Is it the same thing? Wherever you go in the natural world, there are still mysteries to solve. Sadly, this winter we haven't spent as much time on northern burrows as we did last year, but we did manage to get out last week and photograph these ducks. I think they're the same species, but it would appear that they're either sexually dimorphic or that one lot are juveniles, because they're markedly different. I know what I think they are, but what do you think they are? Can you give me an identification? And here's rather a nice photograph that I took of an oyster catcher. In fact, to be more accurate, two oyster catchers. And now, whilst on the subject of birds, it seems like a good idea to go over to my lovely wife Corinna for our regular monthly visit to the Watcher of the Skies.
I've always felt a curious affinity with this species of bird, probably because for 30 years I was a secretary, and this is a secretary bird. A highly specialised ground-dwelling bird of prey from an older family than the other Old World raptors. It is native to sub-Saharan Africa and is sadly non-migratory, so will never be a natural visitor to these shores. But I think you'd be surprised quite how many completely unexpected avian visitors Britain does have, and that's what this segment on the track is all about. Bernard Heuvelmans himself said that cryptozoology wasn't the study of monsters, but the study of unexpected animals. And in the UK, what could be more unexpected than vultures, spoonbills and albatrosses? Yes, even the kings of the Southern Ocean have been seen in British waters. Two species of albatross have been recorded in the UK in recent years. Not all of our feathered visitors are quite so spectacular, but nearly every day there is something exciting to greet the Watcher of the Skies.
Good afternoon. Once a fairly regular annual visitor to these shores, the pied-billed grebe dramatically reverted to a mega rare vagrant during the early and mid part of the 2000s. However, on the 16th of February, there was a confirmed sighting in Somerset at Hamwall RSPB. It's a small diving bird with a chicken-like beak and hails lakes and ponds across North America. Although a migrant bird, it is rarely seen flying and prefers to sink out of sight when threatened and only migrates at night. Stray individuals have turned up in Europe and Hawaii. It swims like a duck but does not have webbed feet, having lobes that extend out from each toe to the sides, which provide extra surface area for paddling. It breeds on seasonal or permanent ponds with dense vegetation and can be seen on most types of wetland in the winter. It feeds on fish, crustaceans being especially fond of crayfish, and aquatic insects. It was first recorded here in 1963, again in Somerset, and if you are lucky enough to spot one, it would be most likely during October to January. On the 18th of February, a Drake Harlequin duck was found on the west coast of the Western Isles at Balranald on northwest, representing the first since 2007. It is only the 18th to grace British waters and is the first witchable male for 25 years. There is a population of around 3,000 birds on Iceland, which is the only European country that hosts breeding pairs of this duck. This accidental visitor is classed as a mega vagrant to our shores and winters in Western Europe, Eastern China and the Southern United States along rocky coastlines and breeds in Greenland, Iceland, Siberia and North America on fast flowing streams. When engaged in behavioural interactions, the harlequin duck gives distinctly unduck-like squeaks, the source of one of its local names, the sea mouse. A pine grosbeak, the first for nearly 21 years, was spotted near North Mavine on Shetland on the 29th of January, but the news of this sighting was not reported until the 1st of February. This bird has a circumpolar distribution and breeds in pine forests north to the tree line from Scandinavia eastwards throughout Siberia as well as throughout Canada. A mega visitor to our shores, it is one of the largest members of its family and is the largest and rarest of the winter finches. Winter flocks have been known to stay near a tree with abundant fruit until all of it is consumed and the breeding adult develops pouches in the floor of its mouth for carrying food to young. Most of the year its diet is 99% vegetable matter, buds, seeds, fruits of spruce, pine, juniper and the like, but it feeds insects and spiders to its young mixed with plant foods. It also drinks water or eats snow daily. It breeds in northern Eurasia and northwest North America and winters south to central Europe, northern China and the central United States, and it was first recorded here in Durham in 1831. A Drake Back-Isle teal, a dabbling duck also known as the bimaculate duck or squawk duck, was found at Tecumseh in Wexford on the 8th of February. This rare vagrant is an accidental visitor and breeds in northeastern Asia and winters in eastern China, Japan and Korea. It feeds on seeds and grain, water snails, algae and other water plants quite often at night. It was first recorded in 1906 in Essex. This bird did suffer a decline in numbers, most probably due to hunting, which does still remain a serious threat. In China and South Korea, birds are killed by poisoned grain, and pesticide poisoning and pollution from agricultural and household waste are thought to be a serious problem on the Gwem River in South Korea, as well as up to 12 incidences per day of disturbance from low-flying aircraft. On the 2nd of February at Baltimore Fish Factory in Cork came the sighting of the first winter American herring gull, also known as the Smithsonian gull. This rare vagrant breeds in North America and Northeast Asia and winters south to Central America and Southern Asia. It lives on seacoasts, lakes and rivers and is omnivorous, eating mostly animal material but also scavengers and pirates' food. It was first recorded here in Cheshire in 1994. In general, herring gulls prefer drinking fresh water, but they'll drink seawater when they must. Special glands located over the eyes allow them to excrete the salt that would otherwise dehydrate most animals, including us. The salty excretion can be seen dripping out of their nostrils and off the ends of their bills. They also have been known to partake in a spot of bait fishing. One was seen floating bits of bread on the surface of a Paris pond and attacking goldfish feeding on the bread. It ate none of the bread itself, indicating deliberate tool use. And that's it for this month, folks. So it's now over to Jonathan for the monthly look at new and rediscovered species. So until next time, bye-bye.
A team of young researchers from Colombia have recently found two new species of salamander that were discovered during a project supported by the Conservation Leadership Programme and Save Our Species. The two new salamanders belong to the genus Bodotoglossa, otherwise known as tropical climbing or web-footed salamanders. One of the salamanders, B. Leandre, has been named after an 11-year-old girl who became friends with the team whilst they conducted their fieldwork. Leandro grew fascinated by the world of amphibians, explains team leader Aldemar Alcavedo. She was eager to learn about our work and became an excellent spokesperson for nature conservation amongst the community. Scientists from the University of Aberdeen have discovered a new species of fish near New Zealand. The animal was found on a voyage to one of the deepest points on the planet. During 7 days of ocean sampling near the Kermadec Islands at depths of between 1 and 6.5 kilometres, the crew took over 6,500 photographs of deep sea fish and snapped around 100 fish. The experts discovered a new species of eelpout at depths of 4,250 metres, new depth records of 5,500 metres for rat-tail fish, another rat-tail fish which has not been caught in New Zealand waters for over 100 years, and new depth records of 3,500 metres for large deep-sea cusk eels. Scientists from the University of Aberdeen's Ocean Lab, NIWA and Museum of New Zealand at Te Papa Tongarawa combined to explore the waters well below the depth that light penetrates. Voyage leader Dr. Alan Jameson from Ocean Lab said, "We're never quite sure what we'll find on these expeditions to uncharted territories. We'd set out to find out more about the deep sea fish communities and were delighted to find both new species and new depth records for fish." Still in New Zealand, we've got some very good news now. A large colony of endangered South Island long-tailed bats has been discovered during a January survey on Derville Island in the Marlborough Sounds. The Derville population is estimated to number in the hundreds, according to New Zealand conservation organisation Forest and Bird. The colony was discovered by a Forest and Bird survey team during the fifth and final year of surveys initiated by the Southfield officer Debs Martin alongside bat scientist Dr. Brian Lloyd. Only 10 colonies of long-tailed bats are known to remain on the South Island mainland. with total numbers less than 5,000 and declining. This find is fantastic news, says Miss Martin. It means that Derville Island is even more important to New Zealand's natural heritage than we thought. Derville Island is the fifth largest island in New Zealand. One third of it is public conservation land. It is free of possums and ship rats, which increases the long-tailed bat's chances of survival. Except for a small colony on Stewart Island, the Derville group is the only one known to be living on an offshore island. This find dramatically increases the chances of saving the species from extinction, says Miss Martin. It was predicted that the South Island long-tailed bat would become extinct within 50 years, but this find may well alter that.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, that's about it for this episode. I hope you enjoyed it. I'd like to say thank you to all the usual suspects for helping me through this month, and in particular my lovely wife, Corinna. But I'd like to also say thank you to Carl Marshall, who, as we speak, is on his way to Borneo for an expedition of exploration, and I look forward to hearing about his adventures next month. Also, I'd like to thank Graham Inglis for his camera work, and also Richard Freeman for his input. But most of all this month, I'd like to say thank you to Steve Jones and Terry Colvin, but for whom there wouldn't actually be an episode. Well, not for a while yet, because we had another computer disaster. When we came back from Mother's house in Oakham, two separate hard drives failed on me and I lost a lot of data. Out of the blue, Terry and Steve donated the money for the data recovery services to recover all the missing data, which is now backed up in several different places, including a SkyDrive, so this hopefully will never happen again. Thank you very much, my dear friends. It is very, very sweet of you, and I don't know what I would have done without you. This is looking like it's going to be an exciting year, as the CF said. Animals and Men, our long-missing journal, is on its way back. We're working on issue 50 as we speak. And also, the CFZ yearbook will be out before the next episode. There are a lot of exciting things to be looking forward to, including this year's Weird Weekend, which will be held, as always, on the third weekend in August. So until then, guys, be seeing you.
Strangely strange, but hardly normal. La 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 la